Sunday kind of love, a love to last past Saturday night, and I'd like to know it's more than love at first sight. I want a Sunday kind of love.
Oh. That was the inevitable Etta James in A Sunday Kind of Love. This is NC Fro is Reading, broadcasting on a Sunday evening in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and I am your host, Felicia Baxter. Well, what's going on with me? There's not a whole bunch going on in Chattanooga today. I had the pleasure of coming back into town yesterday from Kentucky. I'm glad I actually took the time to do two very important things. One was stopping to the Sweetwater dairy farm in Philadelphia, Tennessee. I have enough cheese to last forever. And this is from someone that is lactose intolerant. So we will see how all that goes. But the reason why I bought the smoked Gouda and the sharp cheddar is because I will be accepting a shipment from Traveling Vineyard. I still am a Traveling Vineyard representative. But I have not ordered anything or had the pleasure of enjoying some of the rich red wines from California or all over the country. So I'm actually pretty much looking forward to that. I'm also getting ready to test my mettle or learn how to test my mettle as far as wine tasting, because I also signed up for a master class that I will be participating in. In addition to learning how to produce music from such greats as, oh, what's his name? He's from Virginia. I can see his melon head. Oh, I can't think of his name. It'll come back to me. But I plan on completing two master classes, and also I'm going to need to go to the app to download a couple of the classes, because I'll be flying for work tomorrow, flying to Texas for work tomorrow. That's what I wanted to kind of, before I jumped into that, I have realized this weekend was pretty much clear that I'm old. And the older that I get, the more that I realize that a couple things. I mentioned yesterday or day before yesterday that I believe that tequila was the of the devil. I'm going to have to add Jack Daniels and gin to that. I believe that both of those are the devil's elixirs. I'm just saying, that's what I heard. I don't believe that this what was I saying? I got all distracted. That daylight savings time is also crap. You know, this spring forward, Jank, I didn't know until I woke up at 7 o'clock this morning, and I had evidently overslept an hour because I had completely forgot that time was going to go up this weekend. So I lost an entire hour, and that basically puts you off for an entire hour. For the entire day. You don't recover that hour until like the fall again, when you get to fall back. And if you're already sleep deprived, you actually are already annoyed. You know, you can't get caught up on your sleep anyways, evidently, according to the specialists. Those who try to get caught up on sleep on the weekend and still have poor sleep habits during the week, it actually is completely counterintuitive. I also, because of losing that hour, I got up too late to get my papers. For you see, my routine is on Sundays going to hold paycheck, getting plenty of bacon and eggs from their breakfast bar, and then getting my papers, the New York Times and the weekend Wall Street Journals. Yes, I subscribe to both of those electronically, but there's nothing like both of those papers in your hand. I just like the feel of it. Damn it, got there too late. They were already gone. I was actually at my desk working at one of my contract gigs. The bacon was actually good. It was perfectly made. And it wasn't so bad or so bad that I had to work on a Sunday, because I'm actually happy for those hours. I get to utilize that money to finally get caught up when I've been so behind financially for the past 2 years. So getting paid extra to do something that I like, I'm okay with that. But what I'm also annoyed that I have to spend time going to flying for another contract that I really don't think that these meetings are going to be applicable for me in the long run. It's going to be more of a sip in the Kool-Aid indoctrination that will not be able to support me in any way to be able to do my daily job. But only thing that it will support is my decision not to stay there beyond another 6 months. And this is probably the first time in in forever since I left the military that I have not crafted a resignation letter the first week of employment by anybody. But anywho, so that's my truth for today. I lost the hour and I'm ticked off about that, but I've actually got to enjoy a whole bunch of music today. One of the things that I did on my way back into town was, as I said, I stopped by not only the Sweetwater farm, but I also stopped by McKay's Used Books and Music. They have a pretty extensive vinyl selection. And because my back was spasming, I didn't get to peruse the hundreds of thousands of cheap vinyl records to add to my collection, but I was able to add 4 pretty impressive selections from Duke Ellington, a couple of swing hits, as well as Glenn Miller. And that's one of the reasons why I decided to also add this little ditty from the Duke himself, because I love the beat of it. I love everything about this song. And for fair use, it was just how amazing he had his own sound when Benny Goodman, as well as Glenn Miller, was just trying to find theirs. He actually was successful during his lifetime, but it paled in comparison to the White Cats that were in the game. But he was in the game. He, Louis Armstrong, Coltrane, they were all in the game long before the White Cats and made that genre at all popular. And I'm going to just play a little sampling for you. It's called Take the A Train by the great Duke Ellington. Thank you. Now, how cool was that? The great Duke Ellington, I can just see everybody doing the jitterbug in the old time dance saloons, getting dressed up to go out, men holding doors for you, buying you drinks with no strings attached. It just brings to mind a former time that we don't or have not witnessed in a very long time. Kind of miss it. Don't miss everything about it, because also during this time of the release of that particular song, racism was at its height. There was a war going on overseas, and black men were dying for a country that did not understand them and actually out and out hated them. And the armed forces were segregated, even though during the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln had reversed the segregation, but Jim Crow had put the segregation and relegated the people like the Tuskegee Airmen, as well as other soldiers that gave their life so willingly for the cause of America. And this dichotomy, because I remember, if I'm correct, I believe Glenn Miller led the troops, and when he went missing in action, it was on coming back or going to somewhere during the wartime. And he was actually a captain in the war where I don't believe Duke Ellington had that same honor. But Duke Ellington had a following, and his music was so influential to the jazz scene, he was not given the same respect, even when you compare him to Glenn Miller. Don't get me wrong, it's not like I don't love Glenn Miller's music, because I absolutely do. I respect him and Benny and Harry and all of those other Caucasian jazz greats, but you can't beat the sound, you can't beat it that the Duke, as well as Louis and Coltrane, all of those guys, what their contributions were to jazz, but they didn't get the same respect. It's taken over 50, 60, 70 years for them to gain the respect that they were due during their lifetime. And if we weren't so backwards during that time, how far they could have gone. But they were able, and on their own right, to create their sound and to be artists and to gain a following in spite of everything and the racism that was pervasive in our country. And I think that is where Rosa Guy, who came up with Wade, or the author of the short story Wade, that was her truth at the time. Give you a little bit of who Rosa Guy was. She was born in 1928, September 2nd, in Trinidad. She grew up in the States. She was best known author of children's books and novels for young adults, such as The Disappearance in 1979 and Paris Pee Wee and the Big Dog in 84. She was a translator, and she also was a playwright. But this short story was in itself a very poignant and telling series of a character that we only know his first name, which was Wade. It's basically, as my synopsis says, it's about a coming of age story during a murder. This kid, who was 22 at the time, or right around the storming of Normandy, was actually on assignment and took his leave during World War II in France. And it was during this, his leave, that he meets a prostitute by the name of Michelle. They would be thrust together in an unlikely time, and he would come to love himself as he started to love someone that he wouldn't ordinarily think to love. And he would also reflect on friendships that he would never have had outside of Lenox Avenue in Harlem during the same period of time. He reflected that being in France was just the best of it. It was slow getting used to that you were a man and not a special kind of man. It was funny as hell, the light feeling that came over you when you fully realized that at home, a whole country had been standing silently on your shoulders, looking at you upside down, and you had been trying to move and get around, acting like a normal man with that weight on your shoulders. You went around pretending and telling yourself, shouting out loud to anyone who would listen, that you were like every other man. He and Michelle, during one of their last times together, he would discover his manhood, his self-worth, but at the expense of another life. Of course, he pointed out, and I thought it was pretty poignant, that they were equal in the abuse each had sustained. The author writes that the abuse she had lived through as a woman made her his equal. She was a young prostitute living through the war as best as she could, and they were thrust together by circumstance. But they would run up against America in the most unlikely place, in a cafe, where a drunk white officer basically comes after Wade. And it wasn't so much that he was protecting himself. He took out his hatred for himself and frustration of everything that was up against him in America out on this stupid drunk soldier. And at the end of the fight that could have well ended when he knocked him down, he basically stomped him and basically kicked his skull in and killed him. And it was just awful. In one simple moment, he made a decision to end this other captain's life. Yes, he was an idiot. Yes, he was spewing hatred. And I'm not sure how I would have reacted to this when, right after the fight, the author writes, the captain looked up into Wade's eyes, his thickened face turning up into a sickly smile. His blue eyes cleared of the drunken haze, blazing clearly in that tiny shaft of moonlight. Fear for his very life glistened here, but it did not hide or erase the hatred that poured out of him. You still, the captain gasped painfully through his bloody lips, ain't nothing but a goddamn nigger. Wade's anger rose like some terrible thing, hardly a part of him, bigger and mightier than he, pushing the man to the ground, then using his foot, he kicked his face, stomping where he knew the head should be, feeling the crushing of the bones beneath his shoe. Then bearing down on his heels, grinding and grinding until he felt nothing but a mass pulp under the heel of his boot. Anger spent, Wade leaned weakly against the tree, wiping his face, trying to get his mind together, but somehow he wasn't able to function. Days he kept looking down, and if it hadn't been for Michelle pulling on him, insisting, Sherry, we must go, he might have stood against that tree for the rest of his night. He found himself suddenly understanding the colored cats who lied and bragged about how important they were back at home, and how real gone things were for them back in the States. He knew now that they had to prove they were like all the world's peoples, that the quotation, from dust you came to dust you will return, had to have the same meaning for them as for all. That there was nothing written up in the Bible or any other goddamn book that said, From dust you come, and you will live like dust, and dust you will be forever be. In killing this racist soldier, it makes me so sad that he had to discover the worth of his life and the worth of Black lives, but it was through murder, and I don't think that could justify the killing in any way, shape, or form. What it does exemplify and also just supports is the meaning of love and how love should win all. I wish he could have left it as kicking this guy's ass, but I would have known at that time if that white soldier had survived. I don't know if he would have had the galls to report him and he would have then gotten court-martialed, or he would have kept silent, because who wants to admit that he got beat up by somebody that was over 3 inches and 20 pounds lighter than he was, and Black to boot. So he was in a lose-lose situation, but I still don't think it justified killing and taking that stupid soldier's life. Also, how Michelle, the girlfriend, probably soon to be his wife, was complicit in the murder. She witnessed it all, but she took it awfully well, because I'm sure it sounds like she probably saw and did worse to support her own survival. The whole story itself, I believe it was just so well written. And again, it just exemplified, you know, the survival in absolutely horrible times. And I can't imagine being a soldier and only 22, having to live through and survive not only the German bullets, but also taking guff from your fellow soldiers, not seen as an equal, but supposed to die for a cause that really didn't apply to you, because you know that rights and everything was not applied easily at home. He basically escaped, just like Josephine Baker and several musicians, jazz musicians during that period of time, escaped to France, because they were seen as adding to the artistry, and they were very entertaining, and they were seen as equals at that time. But the last thing that I wanted to do, and that's actually the end of the story. He goes on to reflect on his newfound manhood, and seems the way the story ended, it seemed to be unlikely that he would return to the United States, because he very seldom would return indefinitely to the United States, because it sounds like there was nothing in 1940s New York City that was all that good for him. He was already made a criminal by the time he was 11. He wasn't supposed to survive World War II. If his mother didn't spend all of his money, he would actually probably have enough to come back and to settle in France. And in my mind, I wish him the best, even though I knew he was a fictional character. But you always root for these types of guys. Because there was really no CSI at the time, he basically would have got, sounds like he got away with murder. And he would have to live with that for the rest of his life, justified in his mind or not. And I also wanted to touch on a little bit of the history of Etta James. She was born just like Billie Holiday. She was born to a teenage mother, and she ended up in foster care, where she was savagely abused by the musical director of the Echoes of Eden choir at church, who basically, in order to get her to sing from her diaphragm, would punch her in the chest. Who freaking does that? he punched his child in the chest. He could have hit her right at the right beat and triggered an arrhythmia that could have killed her. She was also abused by her foster father during drunken poker games. At night, he would actually beat her up out the bed to sing to his drunken poker buddies. That experience would scar her and she would always have difficulties being able to sing on demand because of that experience. For a number of years, she bounced around, and as a teenager, she took her licks, became part of the girl group, the Creolettes, because of all of the members were light-skinned African-Americans. She recorded her first hit song at the age of 15, would go on to some notoriety. There was some difficulty in follow-up of that hit song, but she would go on for a number of years, bouncing from label to label, befriending people such as Elvis Presley, as well as Jackie Wilson. And then she would have a comeback in the 90s prior to her dying. But her quintessential mark and her distinctive voice, where she basically, you can feel where she can actually, you actually feel her feelings through the words of the songs that she's singing. She became exemplary of a genre, and her mark on jazz and R&B and soul can still be felt from today. She had a hard knock beginning. The middle wasn't too good, but her ending was just solidly Etta James. And I'm so grateful that I actually get to enjoy her songs. I have a remastering of her album At Last on vinyl, as well as I have access to her music through Apple Tunes, and I'm just elated to be able to share this last song with you. It exemplifies the ending of Wade by Rosa Guy. And he finds that character found love in a most unlikely place during a most harshest of times, but at least he found that love at last. And NC Fro is leaving you now to listen to one of Etta James's greatest hits, At Last. I hope you enjoyed the reading itself, and I hope you enjoyed the little snippets of the jazz that I've actually been able to share with you today. And I hope you keep reading. This is NC Fro is reading from Chattanooga, Tennessee, and I'm leaving you with Etta James, At Last.
On a Sunday kind of love, a love to last past Saturday night, and I want a Sunday kind of love, a love to last Saturday night.
That was not At Last. It was from the album At Last, but the actual song, where is my song? Hold on, y'all. Hold on.
At last. are over.